Hi, and welcome to this companion video for the Modern Applications Decision Guide. With me today is one of the co-authors, Josh Kahn. Welcome, Josh.
Thanks, Jeff. Thanks for having me.
Do you want to introduce yourself and tell viewers what they should expect from the guide?
Sure. So my name is Josh Kahn. I'm a principal solutions architect, and I'm also the tech leader for Serverless. So I'm responsible for our 1,000-plus person strong community of experts on serverless technology here at AWS.
Fantastic. So before we get into the guides in detail, maybe we can talk a little bit about how we define modern apps. And maybe you could tell us a bit about why customers would want to invest in developing a modern app. Is it just because they want to run it in the cloud, or are there other things that you want to highlight?
Yeah, I mean, that's one reason, but customers do get a lot of value out of building what we term modern applications. Many of, you know, most of our viewers are probably familiar with that term, but it's, you know, kind of having automated deployments, more flexibility, the ability to scale more effectively. And one of the most common questions we get from customers who are looking to build modern applications is, should they follow a serverless path or a Kubernetes path? And that's actually what the decision guide is all about.
Right, okay, so let's switch to talking about those operational models and a bit more about what the operational models, those two that you mentioned, are all about that we cover in the guide.
So we tend to think about serverless and Kubernetes as being two different operational models. We've seen customers be successful building a multitude of different types of applications and workloads using both, frankly. And really what it often comes down to is the skills, the level of effort that the customer or the builder wants to put in versus having us at AWS maintain and run that infrastructure for you. So a serverless operational model is one where you're pushing as much responsibility as possible for the operational standpoint to AWS. And we'll see customers use services like AWS Lambda or Fargate or Amazon ECS, the Elastic Container Service, to build with that serverless operational model. On the other hand, we have a large number of customers who have a preference towards open source or like using the Cloud Native Compute Foundation technologies, CNCF, who prefer to build on Kubernetes. And we have a great opportunity to build with Kubernetes using EKS, the Elastic Kubernetes Service. So if a customer wants to do something like run Ray on Kubernetes, they have the ability to do that as well.
So what are customers going to find in the guide that will help them make the choice? I mean, you talked about what teams they're most appropriate for, but what other things, what other kind of criteria are we going to be talking about in the guide that is going to help customers with this?
Certainly some of the other considerations that are out there, the skills that your team already has, some of the deployment practices, maybe some of the even the packaging practices that your team follows today. But a lot of it does come down to the skills and what type of operating model you as a customer want to follow. And really the thing is that the choice is really and, right? So most large enterprise customers that we work with will use both a serverless and a Kubernetes operating model. And it's best to let the individual teams or the folks building that workload make the right decision for themselves. If you're at a startup or something, a smaller company, you might want to push towards the serverless operating model, although I'm a little bit biased, of course, because you're pushing more of that responsibility to AWS. And we talk about some of those factors in the decision guide.
So one of the other things that I know that we talk about in the decision guide is workloads. So maybe you can tell me a bit about what role looking at your workloads might play in how you make your decision.
So there are some workloads that lend themselves well to one model or the other. One example is what we call an event-driven architecture. A very common example of that, let's say you have an application that allow users to upload a photo and you want to create a thumbnail version or a small version of that photo. So one way to architect that would be to allow the user to upload the file to an Amazon S3 bucket. Putting an object into a bucket generates an event, right? As one of my colleagues likes to say, an event is really just that something happened, and then we want to respond to it, right? So our response to that event might be triggering or invoking an AWS Lambda function to go grab that image, process it, create the thumbnail version, and save it back to the bucket. So that type of event-driven application really lends itself well to the serverless model because of all the deep integrations that it has with the AWS as an ecosystem.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Josh, for giving us a sneak preview of what we're going to see in these guides. And thank you all for joining us. We hope you enjoy using our decision guide, and we look forward to your feedback. Thumbs up, thumbs down, or leave some comments. We'd love to hear from you. Thanks again.